Yep, can I introduce you to the committee members? Great. So we'll start from Matthias and just pass it around.
I'll pass around. Okay. Hello. I saw you last year in France. This is Noah Simon here.
Hello. Nice to meet you. I think I saw you many years ago at Stanford when I was a graduate student.
Hi, I'm Yanji Chen. Nice to meet you.
I'm Kevin Jameson.
Nice to meet you.
Okay, so we're good to go. Okay, so welcome everybody Amit's final exam here. So Amit came to the top from Hebrew University. For almost 5 years ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so he's got bit by the post-selection bug, so he's gonna tell us about estimation and testing following model selection. And we're gonna do the usual thing where he's gonna present for about 50 minutes, and you can ask questions if you feel like something needs to be clarified somewhere, but maybe the bigger questions we'll save for the end, and then audience questions, and then closed session with the committee. And so, yeah.
So today I'll talk about estimation and testing following model selection. This is a topic I've been working on for the last 4 years, about half of the time. And I think we lost Pilar. What
happened? Oops.
I'm going to
try again.
We have a lot of connections here. They're not all fully working. Exactly what is the protocol about what to do now?
It's coming right now. Or?
Yeah, for some reason the connection dropped and the web is not answering.
Soon enough.
We'll probably have.
That's somewhere enough to fail.
Yeah, actually, it's on.
We don't decide
that.
Can wait
a little bit.
Amazing.
Okay.
Welcome back, y'all. What happened? Can you do them there?
No, I just turned it on.
Oh.
Okay.
You can lose a game.
So right now I'm seeing myself. Can you make sure it's clear? Okay. So, the structure of the talk will be as follows. I will first give an introduction and motivation to the problem of inference after model selection. Then I'll quickly describe what we did in the first dissertation project, which was which had to do with estimation. Then we're going to go over to talk about inference for the rest of the talk, and in order to set the stage, I'll introduce a concept called the polyhedral lemma. And then we'll talk about the last two chapters of the dissertation, the first of which is going to be about how to do inference with something we call the conditional bootstrap. And then we're going to talk about some aggregate testing problems. So to introduce the setup and the motivation for the work, suppose that we have some data, and our data comes in the following form. We have a response vector y, and we have a matrix of covariates x. And this matrix of covariates can be very large. If you need an example to hold in your head, x can be a genome sequence from, let's say, 100,000 people, and y can be some continuous measure related to a disease. And what we usually want to do is we want to explain y with x. And the way we're going to do it today is the simplest of ways, via linear regression. And the problem we run into in modern statistical settings is the fact that x might have a lot of data, and a lot of data can be a bit inconvenient in the sense that it might have, let's say, 1,000 subjects and 100,000 or a million or 10 million covariates. And so this creates two problems when you want to work with linear regression. The first problem is that the linear regression model is not identifiable, which is a relatively easy problem to fix. But maybe the more difficult problem is the fact that, let's say that you do have a way to fit a model with 100,000 genome variants. If all you can say is someone is more likely to get sick because their genome is bad, then it's not very helpful. What we might want to be able to do is to identify a small number of genes that will explain high risk of being sick. So the way we can do that is we narrow down our attention to just a small number of covariates. And the way I'm going to propose to do it today is one of the simplest ways to do it, and that's marginal screening. So what we're going to do is we're going to compute the marginal correlation of x of each covariate with the response variable, and include in the model the one with the highest correlation. There are many other fancier ways to do model selection, but we're going to stick with something simple because the principle of the post-selection inference are roughly the same, regardless of how you select your model. So now that we've narrowed down our attention from 100,000 genes to just 10 maybe, we still want to do all the usual things that we do in statistics, such as computing point estimates and confidence intervals and doing statistical tests. And this is not a trivial thing to do. In order to demonstrate why this is not a trivial thing to do, I ran a very small simulation. So I generated data for 100 subjects, 50th covariate for each subject, and a response variable that follows the normal distribution, and only two of the covariates are actually related to the response. And then we narrow down our attention to select the top 10 correlations, and we compute two types of estimates. One of them is a naive estimate, which we just compute from the same data we used for selecting the model, and the other one is an oracle estimate, which sort of assumes that we knew what model we want to work with all along. So in order to compute that, we need to generate a new set of data. So this is the results we get. So what I did here, they plotted the error rates from several different, from around 200 repetitions of this experiment. And what we see is several things. So the first error measure we have is the coverage rate of the confidence intervals. And the coverage rate of the oracle estimate is 95%, because that's how we build confidence intervals. It's a rather trivial result that this should happen. But the naive confidence intervals have a lower coverage rate, and it averages about 85%. So that's below what we're hoping for. The other two estimates we have are for the estimation error, so how well we estimate the regression coefficients, and the prediction error, which is how well we predict the response. In both those cases, you can see that the naive estimate has a much higher error than the oracle estimate. So we paid a price for narrowing down our attention to just a small number of variables. So what my research is on is to try to work with a selected model in such a way as to adjust for model selection. And the approach we take is that of conditional post-selection inference, which we define, I define as a practice of conditioning on specific and well-defined selection events in order to adjust for model selection. And this might be a little bit hard to untangle if you're looking at this for the first time. So I'm going to sort of give in a one-dimensional intuition as to how it works. So suppose that we observe y, it has a normal distribution, and it has an unknown mean mu. But we don't always want to estimate the mean. For example, if we're seeing that the mean is negligible or not important, then we want to estimate it. And in our case, what is going to make this mean important is if it's large. So this could correspond to, let's say, a certain gene affecting, increasing the risk of some disease. So the way we're going to decide whether the mean is interesting, is to look at the observed value y and check whether it's larger than some threshold c. The issue with this procedure is that if this mean is interesting, but it's not very large, then we can end up in a situation where the mean is larger than zero, but smaller than the threshold. And so if we use the standard estimator for the mean, which is y itself, we'll always overestimate the mean. So the way we think about this problem in conditional post-selection inference is that when you look at data, and then when you look at y, and then decide that this is the estimate for the mean, what you're implicitly doing is that you're maximizing the Gaussian likelihood. But in practice, because of the way we look at the data, that we only report large values, we don't observe a Gaussian likelihood, we observe the tail distribution of a Gaussian. And the likelihood of that, and the distribution of that, is a truncated normal distribution, which is simply given by the normal density divided by the probability of observing what you observe, times an indicator for the support, which I forgot in blue there. And this likelihood is very different because the Gaussian likelihood is nice and round, and the truncated likelihood is just really weird, and its shape changes as you move it around. But if you work with this likelihood, we can get better estimates and confidence levels. So the first chapter of my dissertation is about conditional estimation, and that was the topic of the general exam. So I'll only very briefly mention what we did there. So we looked at the estimates that are produced post-selection from the same data used for model selection as we've seen before, and we wanted to produce better estimates. And the way to do it, arguably, is to maximize not the unconditional distribution, but the conditional distribution, the conditional likelihood. So the issue with doing that is the conditional likelihood is generally intractable because it involves the normalization constant that's an integral over exponentially many regions. So what we did is that we developed a stochastic optimization framework which allows us to maximize the likelihood without evaluating it. And these are just some gradient effect plots for that. So what I did here is that I took the figures from the previous experiment and just added the conditional estimates. So the naive is still pretty bad, the oracle is still much better, but now the conditional estimates are almost as good as the oracle. In practice, if you'll compute averages of how well these estimates do, under many settings, the oracle will do better eventually. We get almost the same results for half the data. Because if you want to compute the oracle estimate, you need to go to the field and connect and redo your experiment. All right. So that's what we did with regards to estimation. And then we wanted to propose solutions to the problem of inference, which means testing and confidence intervals. And that's something that people have already done before. And most works in this field have mostly relied on a technique called the polyhedral lemma, which I want to describe next in order for everything that comes afterwards will make sense. So why is it difficult to compute post-selection tests? Naively, it shouldn't be so hard. We have our conditional distribution, and we can plug in parameters into the conditional distribution under the null, and sample from it, and get quantiles of distributions. But the reason this is difficult to do is the fact that, let's say I want to infer on just one coordinate of my selected model, which would be beta j in this case. So I can write this probability of beta j being some extreme value, get the p-value. But the issue here is that I'm only interested in beta j, but I need to know the entire vector of beta. Because as we move conditional distribution around, its shape changes. So what I did here in order to demonstrate that is I have a two-dimensional model, and I fix beta 1 to 0, but then I'm changing beta 2 and computing the quantiles of the distribution. And as you can see, as I'm changing beta 2, the tails of both distributions change. So if I don't know beta 2 in this case, I might make a mistake when I compute the p-values for beta 1. So the polyhedral lemma was introduced to solve this problem, and it solved it in a very smart way. So the model we're going to work with, we have vector y, which has a normal distribution, and we want to infer some linear function of the mean of y. This should be the mean, not y itself. And this linear function is going to depend on some event, which we call s of y. So in order to do that, what we're going to do is that we're going to define z, which is a function only of the linear function that we're working with, and w, which is given by y minus z, and by construction, w and z are going to be independent of one another. And so, what the polyhedral lemma says is that if you want to infer on this linear function of the mean, then what we need to do is to condition on a selection event, but also on the observed value of w. And then what you get is a univariate truncated normal distribution, which only depends on the parameter you care about. And this truncated normal distribution has a support given by A of w, which is just all the values of the linear function that will give you the same model that you selected originally. So this is a very elegant and quite simple result, and it's very useful because we now don't have to worry about all of the parameters of the distribution. We only need to worry about the parameters of the distribution that you're interested in. So
Theta here is a vector.
Theta here is a vector, yeah.
So when you say y minus z, z is a scalar. Oh, no, sigma times
instead of, we have it, okay, so we went ahead and we computed confidence intervals with the polyhedral lemma for the marginal screening problem. And what we get is fairly large confidence intervals. So we have the naive confidence intervals in red. They're right here. They're very small. I can make it larger to help you see. And the polyhedral confidence intervals are typically much, much larger. In fact, a paper came out recently that said that in the context of the lasso, the expected size is infinity. So the polyhedral confidence intervals are great in the sense that they're exact, and you can rely on them, but it's not great because they're very large, and I told you that we're going to get something for almost nothing. So we wanted to see if we can come up with a different way to construct post-selection confidence intervals. And the way we thought that we can do it is with a bootstrap, because the bootstrap solved everything. Or so we hope. So here's our proposal for post-election bootstrap. We're going back to the one-dimensional example, and afterward we're going to generalize the idea that we're going to develop here. So once again, we observe y, it's univariate, and we're estimated in the mean of y if y is large. But now we know already that we need to work with a conditional distribution, so this is how we're going to do it. We're going to estimate the mean with y itself. Then we're going to plug this mean into a truncated normal distribution and sample from it. And then we can compute the residual distribution of what we see.
Or just say what the m is instead.
Yes. M defines the support of the truncated normal distribution. I didn't define it properly, but that's what I tried to say. So we can compute the residuals, and based on the residuals, compute bootstrap confidence intervals. And this is what we get from this experiment. These are the confidence intervals, which is what we generated the distribution from. And that's not good, because we were aiming for 95% coverage rate, and we got 70% disappointment. So the question is, why does this happen? And the reason it happens is because of this location non-invariance problem, where when you move the conditional distribution around, it changes its shape. So this is the shape of the distribution that we were trying to estimate. This is the true distribution of the results. But when we plug in the observed value into the distribution, what you get is this sort of shapes, depending on the exact realization of your experiment. And there are the wrong shapes, and that's why you get a wrong coverage rate. So this problem with location non-invariance and issues with convergence of bootstrap distributions has been encountered before. And in one place that people run into it is when trying to bootstrap the Lasso estimators. So Chatterjee and Lahiri, what they try to do is simply get the distribution of Lasso estimators, not conditionally, but marginally overall. And what they found is that the bootstrap distribution of the Lasso estimators does not converge, or it converges to a random measure. And the solution they found is that if they set small coefficient to zero and then sample residuals, then they can get a bootstrap distribution that converges. And this gives them good confidence intervals. So we wanted to apply a similar solution. But residual bootstrap is difficult for selection because any model has a very low probability of being selected. So you would have to sample to infinity. But what we can do is use efficient parametric samplers to do inference. So here is our modified bootstrap procedure. As before, we observe this variable y that we only observe if it's large, and we estimate the mean with y itself. Then we also compute the threshold that estimate of the mean. And in this case, we're going to do a post-selection test and reject the null only if the observed value is very large. So S here needs to be very small. And so this equals either the observed value or zero. And then we just plug in this threshold that estimates mu tilde into the truncated normal distribution and estimate that our distribution is before and compute a bootstrap confidence interval. And what we get here is, number one, much wider confidence intervals, but these confidence intervals are also, they also get the correct coverage here. So that's nice. But it's useful because for the univariate problem, we already have really good ways of computing confidence intervals, namely by test inversion. So on its own, this is not very useful. But what's nice about it is that we can generalize this to multivariate problems.
So for this picture, there's some choice of S, right?
Yes. S here is some value that gives the confidence level a conservative coverage rate regardless of the value of the mean. And you can find it by long search. Okay. So we want to generalize this to a multivariate setting. So here's going to be our multivariate setting for the stock. We assume that we observe some multivariate random vector y, but what we care about is some test statistic t that we use to do screening, which is a function of y. And what we assume about this test statistic is that it satisfies asymptotic normality, and that the way we do our model selection is by something that looks like marginal screening. So this is very simple and very much aimed at marginal screening, but you can actually, if for example you index the statistic by the models that you're estimating, then you can get, then you can generalize this to problems such as Lasso. So this is a pretty big slide with all the steps for doing the multivariate conditional bootstrap. But it's kind of complicated, so I'll just mention that we have a tuning parameter S of n, which changes with sample size and tells us how to threshold our parameters. And we can do bootstrap for continuous differentiable functions. And the way I'm going to describe this algorithm is actually with pictures. So suppose that we have data. What I did here is that I generated y and x of before and computed the inner product of the covariance with the response to get the sufficient statistics, which are also proxy for the correlations, assuming that the x vectors are normalized. We then do model selection, meaning that we draw a line somewhere quite arbitrarily at the top 10 variables. And we only include in the model the left observed variables. We then apply thresholding. And the way we apply thresholding is by a type of approximate condition post-selection p-value, which is just based on probability of inclusion of a single variable in the model. But we don't need the p-value to be exact for this to work. After we do that, we compute something I call the thresholded coefficients. So in the linear regression case, we can transform the sufficient statistics into regression coefficients using the X transpose X inverse matrix. And while the thresholded, we only have two test statistics that we say that they have non-zero means, when we look at the coefficients, most of them have non-zero means. Because of dependence between the regressors. We then take our parametric bootstrap sample. So as you see, everything that was not selected is forced to be small, and everything that was selected is forced to be above some thresholds. And then we can transform this sample into regression coefficients, and then into residuals. And based on the residuals, we can compute confidence intervals. So this is our residual, these are the confidence intervals that we get. And as before, we have the polyhedral confidence intervals in blue, which are rather large. So I'm going to zoom in to show us our confidence intervals. And our confidence intervals are now in green. And as you can see, they are larger than the naive confidence intervals, but they're not huge. They're on average about 40% larger. So now you might be asking yourself, do we have any guarantees or can we say anything about this procedure? So what we can say is the following. Under some assumptions, and these are not the most general assumptions, but if we can bound the probability of selection of a specific model from below, and we send this threshold parameter to zero, but not fast, then our confidence intervals will obtain the correct coverage rate. The issue with result is that in post-selection inference, because of this non-invariance, we usually want uniformity statements. And this is not uniform, this is point-wise for any specific model data generating process as our sample size grows. So in order to find out how our method works in finite samples as well, we ran a more comprehensive simulation study. So we generate data for 200 subjects with 100 covariates, and as before, we select the 10 highest correlations. We have different different types of sparsity settings and many types of signal-to-noise ratios. And we have two designs, autocorrelated and independent for the covariates. And maybe the more important part is to talk about what we do with threshold being parameter. So as we said, we don't have any uniform statements we can make about our method, because there's actually results that says that it's impossible to approximate the distribution of selected regression coefficients exactly and uniformly. So what we're trying to do is to be conservative. And the way we do it is by setting most of the mean parameters to zero. And we do that by setting the threshold mean parameter that's Bonferroni corrected 1%. So in this case, it's 0.001. And usually when we set a mean parameter to zero, we get a wider confidence interval. So this is the idea behind how we're hoping to get finite sample results. So we ran our simulations, and what we got is that our procedure in all cases got the correct coverage rate or higher, and so did the polyhedral confidence intervals. Here they look like they're undercovering a little bit, but it's probably simulation, the polyhedral confidence intervals have finite sample guarantees. And maybe the more interesting simulation measures that we want to look at is the size of the confidence intervals. So what I am plotting here is a quantification of the ratio between the conditional confidence intervals and the naive confidence intervals. And I do it at the log 2 scale, so if we are at 1, it means that the conditional confidence interval is twice as large on typically than the conditional confidence interval and the naive confidence interval. So when we have independent design, in all cases, our confidence intervals tend to be about 40% larger, and the polyhedral confidence intervals around 4 times larger. In autoregressive design, something slightly different happens, where our confidence intervals are about the same size as a naive confidence interval, but the signal-to-noise ratio is low, and becomes higher as the signal-to-noise ratio increases. And one last question that we're going to ask is whether this smaller size translates to better power, and the answer is sometimes. So under independent design, we can get increased power sometimes up to 20%. But with dependent design, selection is not so bad, or its effects are not so severe, because most of the coordinates of the mean vector do have signal. So what we get is that our power is just slightly higher in some cases, and when the signal-to-noise ratio is high, it's actually a bit lower. So far, what we have is a procedure for computing confidence intervals that give us short confidence intervals, and it's going to be point-wise consistent and conservative in finite samples. But we have problems with uniformity and with the fact that for any fixed experiment, we can't really tell you that our confidence intervals are going to work. So what I'm going to describe next is sort of a start of an idea of how we can deal with it, of how we can give finite sample guarantees without conditioning on too much. and we're going to do it in the context of aggregate testing. So here is the model selection setting that we're going to work with now. Suppose that we observe y as a normal distribution, and this time we estimate the mean if we can reject an aggregate test. So this is a relatively straightforward and pretty nice generalization of the one-dimensional problem. And for us, it was motivated by an application in the networks. But some really nice things came up while we were working on this problem. So the first thing we did when we worked on this project is to find out what is the polyhedral lemma for this problem. And this is what we get. As before, we can compute W and we can compute Z. And then we can define this set A of W, which we defined our truncation. And this set is just given by the fact that our contrast in absolute value needs to be larger than some function of this W. And the way it works is that the larger W is, the smaller the truncation is going to be, and the smaller our p-value is going to be. So if W is small, our p-values are going to be large. And this W is going to be small in two cases. One case is if there is no signal in W. And the other case is if we have very weak signal in the data. So what do we do if we think that we have very little signal in the data? Well, here's what we're going to try to do. So we're going to define the following problem. We want to find a mean parameter, a parameterization mu tilde, such that the p-value for the contrast that interests us is going to be larger than any other p-value we can compute. And if we do that, we can get valid inference, because we went for the most conservative result. But this is a difficult problem in general. So what I plotted here is surfaces of this p-value function in the marginal screening problem. And depending on your covariance matrix, you can get relatively nice surfaces like this, which give you maximum zero, or really ugly, or I don't know, I think it's actually pretty cool, surfaces like this with multiple modes and weird shapes. So in general, it's a very difficult problem, but in aggregate testing, it is actually a pretty cool result, and the result is that the global null, assuming that there is no signal in the data, is the most conservative parameterization for testing any hypothesis with a linear contrast. So now we have two types of p-values. We have p-value computed based on the polyhedral lemma, which works well when there's a lot of signal in the data and it's not sparse. And we have the global null p-values, which work well when the true data generic distribution is close to the null, because then it's almost exact. The question is how to adapt to any data generic distribution, and the idea we came up with is actually rather trivial. It's just taking twice the mean of the two types of p-values. That's the minimum of two types of p-values. And this gives us valid p-values because it's a Bonferroni correction. And both types of p-values are valid. So we tested a bunch of stuff with our these two p-values. So the first thing we wanted to check is how they work for false detection rate control. And what we found is that they do control the false detection rate in all settings, except for when we generated data with heavy tail distribution. So this could be expected because all of the polyhedral lemma theory and the global null theory, they all rely on Gaussian assumption. Then the other thing that we did, which is maybe more interesting, is to look at the power to detect signal. So the first setting, first, we describe the plot. We have the power on the y-axis. We have a sparsity level on the x-axis. And the signal size changes and increases in the panels. So when the signal size is low, the polyhedral lemma has very little power, and both the hybrid and the global nullity values have better power. And when the signal size is low, when we have only one per signal in the data, the polyhedral lemma is still not great. But then as we increase the number of non-zero coefficients, it becomes better than the other two p-values, but the hybrid p-value is still pretty good. It's almost as good as a polyhedral one. So these are the three products that are in my dissertation. So to conclude, I worked on doing conditional inference, and the main goal was to figure out ways to work with a full conditional distribution rather than conditioning out a lot of the dimensions of it. And in the first project, we worked on conditional estimation. So through doing conditional estimation, we got better point estimates and better predictions. In the second project, we worked on inference after aggregate testing. And we did more than what I presented here today. But the main thing is that we proposed the concept of inference under a most conservative parameterization. And we also introduced fast algorithms for computing the maximum likelihood estimate. So it turns out there are really cool shortcuts you can do in the aggregate testing setting. And in the last chapter, which was the second chapter in the presentation, we described a conditional bootstrap approach, which gave us improved power because we were doing less conditioning. And we were able to give point was very good for it. And we were hoping that it does turn out that we managed to do good finite sample construction. I don't know what the time now is. We're quite a bit over time. No,
we're
good.
Okay.
All right. So there are a few other projects that I've been working on during my dissertation that are not in this presentation or my dissertation, which I would like to mention. So the first one is a project with Yuval Benjamini, where we were trying to compute confidence intervals for selected regions. What's happening in this figure is that we have this red curve that we're observing, and we are interested in estimating the signal in the curve whenever it crosses this gray threshold. And the way we compute confidence intervals for this problem is by profile likelihood, meaning that for each possible mean value, signal in the curve, we compute a profile likelihood estimate of the rest of the regression of the parameters and check whether we reject or reject this parameter or not. And it gives pretty nice results. A second project is something I've been working on with Yoav. And in this project, we are looking at a replication study of 100 psychology experiments. And what we argue is that if you take a conditional lens to this data and assume that you only observe significant results, you can actually explain a lot of the non-replicability of the that we observe in the experiment. Another project with a sub-Weinstein generalizes some empirical Bayes estimation concepts of Brad Efron, where his idea is that if you want to estimate the signal in selected in selected variables, let's say the extreme observations, you can do that by computing an empirical Bayes estimate of the marginal distribution of your observations and applying something called the Tweedy formula. So what we found is that when you estimate this non-parametric distribution of the data, you don't actually need to observe the entire distribution. It's sufficient to observe the tables of this distribution. And so you can do the same trick and get very good estimates just based on the tails, which are the selected coordinates. selected variables. And last, but definitely not least, is a project I've been working on at the Hutch with Rafael Gutardo and Greg Fina, about half of my time. And this is a pretty cool problem with modeling flow cytometry data, where we use hidden Markov random field models to model dependencies between different cell subsets and try to explain susceptibility to disease based on blood measurements. It's quite complicated, so I won't go into it. All right, so that is all. Yes. I have a little question. So I have a lot of people to thank because I've been doing this thing for 5 years and haven't been doing it alone. So the first people I would like to thank are my collaborators. So first one is Matthias, he's my advisor. He's been really great. I really appreciate the fact that your door was always open to me and you're always happy to have me come in and tell you about my random ideas. And that you always try to understand what's going on and give good advice. And you did good. And also, obviously, I think my writing was not the way to start out with. And my staff theory skills needed to be honed, so I really appreciate your help. And then I also want to thank you all, who was the one who introduced me to the post-election problem at all. And gave me a home in Tel Aviv University on several occasions. So I'm very, very grateful for introducing me to this world. Then there are my other collaborators I was very fortunate to have many of them. So with Ruth and Milanda, I worked on the RGA testing problem. Asaf is my friend from Stanford who just finished his postdoc at Stanford. And we're working on the empirical base problem with Yuval Benyamini. It's a Hebrew university, and Rafael and Greg in their special sense because they gave me an amazing problem to work on at the Hutch, and B, they provided some financial support for my PhD, but also C, allowed me to dedicate roughly half my time to something completely non-related to what I am doing at the Hutch. And I'm really grateful for that. Apart from that, I would like to thank my parents who may or may not be viewing this on YouTube because they're just amazing parents. And in my life, they've always actively refused to tell me what to do. And they've always been super supportive for everything they did. And Ilana, who's now my fiance. And I wouldn't have been able to do it without her. So, that's
it. Okay. I guess now everybody has questions many times. Feel free to shoot.
Yeah. You mentioned some tricks for adaptive hypothesis testing. What are the tricks?
The trick for computing the maximum likelihood estimate, maximum likelihood estimator. So, in the aggregate testing problem, you can actually transform any conditional inference, any conditional estimation problem into the problem of first setting the probability of selecting a model and then searching over the parameters that maximize the likelihood under that constraint of the probability of selecting the model being fixed. So in aggregate testing, you can actually solve that in finite. You can actually solve that problem in closed form, and then all you have to do is line search over the probability over the different probabilities for selecting the model. So you turn a multivariate problem into a lattice problem. So that's
okay.
I think in the conditional bootstrap simulations, you had the number of true non-zero means were 2 and 8 or something. How important is it that it's less than the actual number that you're selecting?
I don't know. I think the reason I set up this way is because in modern statistics, we like to think about sparse problems for some reason. It's not necessarily the right way to think about anything. It could be interesting to see how it changes. My guess is that, so what I've seen in the aggregate testing problem, where we really simulated a lot, is that the moment you go above three or four non-zero coefficients, it pretty much behaves the same. We can make it keep growing, and it will roughly be the same. But I'm also seeing that the naive estimator won't be that if not everything is non-zero.
Muted this. I was like, I had this moment right now.
I mean, so you want to hang on to the computer, right?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm going to be in a